This is kind of the first part of my long talk, which effectively was split into two. On Monday, I gave actually the last part about energy inequality. So today, I'll be talking about the first part, where originally the whole thing started. That's about inequality in distribution of money, income, and debt, as opposed to energy, which was discussed on Monday. Okay, and this is kind of review of the work that I've been doing since year 2000. So that's when I published the first paper titled Statistical Mechanics of Money. So anyway, so the outline will be this. I'll discuss briefly the whole idea of the statistical mechanics of money, and then also debt, kind of briefly. And then I spent quite a bit of time discussing actual data on income inequality. So that's basically the plan. Okay, so let me start with actually showing a little bit on historical knowledge, showing two portraits. This is Ludwig Boltzmann. And for those who are not physicists in the audience, you know, he's one of the founders of statistical physics, statistical mechanics. He lived late 19th century. And in physics, what is associated with the name of Boltzmann and also Gibbs is probability distribution of energy. So Boltzmann gives distribution, which we teach in statistical physics, tells us that probability to find a particle with energy epsilon in a gas, say, is exponential function of decreasing exponential function of energy epsilon normalized to coefficient of energy. Okay, and then there's another portrait. This is Wilfredo Pareto. So I'm sure economists know about him. Although he was educated as an engineer, so in that sense he's also like a physicist by education. And among other things he did, he studied inequality in income and wealth in the late 19th century, and he looked at some data and concluded that it follows power law. So since then it's known as Pareto power law. Anyway, these two equations, these two mathematical functions, these two names will show up repeatedly in my talk, so I just wanted to show from the beginning. And let me proceed to the main starting point. Basically, some kind of analogy that I'm showing on the next slide between distributions of money or income and energy epsilon. So let me show how this analogy works. First, let's very brief reminder, half a slide about physics. Suppose we have a gas. So there are molecules moving around and they collide. So two molecules with energies epsilon 1, epsilon 2 collide, and some energy delta epsilon get transferred from one molecule to another, and they fly away with new energies, epsilon 1 prime, epsilon 2 prime. As you see, of course, energy is conserved in the collision. So the sum of initial energies is equal to the sum of final energies. And then after we have, so let's say we have a closed box and many collisions, and after a while it comes to some kind of statistical thermal equilibrium, we ask what will be the probability distribution of energy in that system, stationary probability distribution. There are various ways to derive it. One is from something called detailed balance. There are many other derivations, but detailed balance, okay, let me illustrate this one. In statistical equilibrium, the number, so the left-hand side of this equation gives us the number of transitions from this configuration to that configuration. So it's proportional to probability of making transition times occupation number of this state and occupation number of that state. Okay, that's this formula. But on the other hand, the reverse transitions are also possible. There is a probability making the reverse transition, and the rate of reverse transition is proportional to occupation number of these states. Now, in physics, we have something called time reversal symmetry, which is equations of motion the same forward and backward in time. So these probabilities cancel out. And then we have two very simple equations, which can be summarized like this. Energy is additive, probability is multiplicative. So the only solution of these equations is exponential function. You can easily check. If this is exponential, second equation is always satisfied, first satisfied. End of derivation. So amazingly, we derive a stationary solution, stationary probability distribution, actually without knowing details of dynamics, provided it has certain symmetry, that means time reversal symmetry. That's kind of an amazing result. Another way to derive it, this exponential distribution is maximizing entropy. So I'll maybe talk about entropy a little bit more next slide, but bottom line, one can introduce a function called entropy for this probability distribution, and Boltzmann told us that, thermodynamics tells us that this entropy is maximum, the equilibrium is maximal. And so if you maximize this entropy function subject to constraint on fixed total energy, you get the same result, exponential distribution. Anyway, this is so far physics, and physicists actually know about this. If not physicists, I mean, this is too short to explain. But what I'm going to do now is replace energy by money. And so now we have an ensemble of economic agents instead of atoms. And each agent has some money balance. So we're talking about monetary economics, where every transaction involves money. So let's say agent, and this agent has money balance M1, this has money balance M2, and this agent number 2 now buys something from agent 1. And so he pays amount delta M. Okay, for example, I buy like a cup of coffee from Harry. So I pay him $1. So his balance goes up $1, my balance goes down $1. But as you see, the sum of money, another drink coffee and coffee disappears, and we never see each other again, but his account is $1 up, my $1 is down. So this is final transaction. And the point is that, but the sum of cost of money before and after transaction is the same. So money among in transactions among ordinary agents is only transferred. So in that sense, it looks similar to this energy kind of collision. So transactions are similar to energy collisions between molecules. And then they may ask, if you have a big ensemble of agents, what will be the probability distribution of money that would develop in the system? And by similar kind of arguments, I can make a conjecture that it will be given by Boltzmann Gibbs distribution, which is exponential decreasing exponential function of money. Now, to illustrate this conjecture, let me show you a computer animation, which kind of shows this in a better way. So this is some kind of very simple agent-based simulation. We have some big number of agents. And initially, we give each agent, say, 10 units, say, $10 of money. So we prepare a system in a state of perfect equality. Equality means everybody has the same amount of money. Everybody in this room has initially, say, $10. Perfectly equal state, right? And then we start making transactions. Now, to keep it simple, every transaction will be $1. So we pick a pair of agents, transfer $1. Another pair of agents, transfer $1, and so on. And so that's what we get. So immediately, probability distribution starts to grow. So maybe some agents end up with more money, some agents with less money. So so the first moment of this distribution is conserved because it's a closed system in the simulation. So fixed amount of money, fixed number of people. But the second moment is not conserved. Second moment is growing, like in any diffusion process, random walk, you know, Brownian monitoring, etc. So the message here is that the state of perfect equality is totally unstable. We can prepare a system in this equal state, but once we start making a transaction, we immediately get inequality. But this is not the final state, so I stop simulation, let me run it further. You see that first it was kind of symmetric, kind of Gaussian, but now it's not symmetric because of the boundary condition. So I pose boundary condition at zero, meaning that nobody's balance can go below zero. If I spend all the money, I cannot buy anything anymore. I cannot buy anything anymore. But I can work and get money from somebody and then continue. So bottom line, that means if you pick a transaction and agent has no money to pay, you skip transaction, go to the next transaction. So as a result, probability and density accumulates on this boundary, but there's no boundary on the other side, so it becomes asymmetric. And if you run simulation further, okay, and wait long enough, it approaches to this red line, and the red line is the graph of exponential distribution, and then it stabilizes there. So it becomes stationary at exponential distribution, meaning transactions continue, but probability distribution doesn't change, it becomes stationary. And this graph is, yes, so I would call, so as we see system arrive some kind of stationary, you know, equilibrium state, equilibrium in sense of statistical physics state, which is highly unequal. There are few agents, few rich agents with high money balance, and there are many poor agents with small, low money balance, so that looks like real economy, like real life. And by the way, it's the same as gases in atoms in the gas. So mathematically, it's actually the same thing, there is no difference mathematically. If I put here energy, I would be teaching physics. And then it plays a label, money becomes economic. That's what biophysics are economic, right? Okay, so anyway, and I call this distribution nature of inequality. Nature meaning that inequality develops just by pure probabilities. There was no preferences, there was no skills. All agents were treated the same way, you know, in a statistical sense. So that would be like equal opportunity society. And also it's like extreme model of, you know, free market. Because all transactions are random, I pick any agent, you know, any vendor, etc. And this distribution I call natural because it also maximizes entropy. So the graph here is entropy as a function of time. So now a couple of words about entropy, for those who may not be so familiar, not physicists. Entropy is a combinatorial, as Boltzmann told us, it's a combinatorial variable. It's a logarithm of multiplicity.
Yeah.
Okay, for those who come later, I guess. Yeah. I will play movie again. Okay, because I was just showing...
Victor, we have a question over here from Jürgen.
Yes, yeah. Let's discuss questions and then I play with again. Yes.
It shouldn't be time, actually. Yeah. It should be number of transactions.
True. Number of transactions. Yes, it's a number of exchanges.
This is exactly. Oh, yeah. May be transferred into time. Yeah, if you do them at equal time, then you have a time scale. But first, you have only transactions.
I agree. The natural scale, time scale has actually number of transactions, right? And then maybe like stochastic volatility, maybe not necessarily uniform in time, right? But yeah, it's actually a number of exchanges. But anyway, for those who came late, and it's good to see movie again. Let me play this movie again. Because I think it's kind of very important. A very, very important part of the message, that's why I want to show it. So this is simple agent-based simulation. We have a big number of agents, and we initially give, for people in this room, economic agents. Initially, we give everybody same balance, say $10. Everybody has $10 initially. So the distribution, probability distribution of money is basically delta function, right? Everybody's equal. And then we started making transactions, very simple transactions. I buy a cup of coffee from Kerry, so I pay him $1. So I transfer $1. Coffee disappears, I drink it. So I don't keep track of coffee, I keep track of transfers of dollar units. So pick a pair of agents, transfer $1, another pair of agents, $1, and just keep running. So we see what goes, what happens. So what happens is that this distribution immediately broadens and becomes unequal. So some agents have more money, some agents have less money. The first moment is conserved because the system is closed, but the second moment is not conserved, just keeps growing time. So the state of equality is totally unstable. Ah, Charlie.
I'm sorry.
No problem. Come in. Of course, there's ambiguity. Which room, you know? Third floor, fifth floor.
The other room's neater.
Yeah. But look, this is biophysical conference, okay? Right? And Charlie Hall is the founder of the. So let me play a movie for him again.
It's not going to get to your other things you want to talk about.
Look, it's like, you know, play it against Sam, right? I want to play the movie because the movie, you know, worth a thousand or whatever slides and millions of papers.
Yeah.
Okay. So now again, so Charlie, what we are doing is this: we are doing some very simple agent-based simulation. We have a bunch of economic agents, like people in this room, and we give everybody initially the same amount of money. It's such kind of game. So $10. So the probability, so perfectly equal initial condition. So the distribution, probability distribution of money is basically delta function. Everybody starts with $10, okay? Then we start making economic transactions, very simple. To keep it simple, every transaction is $1, okay? So...
Yeah. One of two already knows all of this.
Take a seat. Be sure about this computer. Okay. So, especially for you. We are doing very simple agent-based simulation. Big number of agents. Everybody initially has $10. Everybody in this room has $10. Probability distribution of money is delta function. Start making transactions. You have a cup of coffee. I pay you $1, you give me a cup of coffee, right? I drink coffee, coffee disappears. You balance $1 up, my $1 down. So, and then pick another pair. So every transaction is $1 among some pair of agents. Let's see what happens. Too fast. Okay, that's it. So, probability distribution starts to broaden, right? Just by pure probability, some agents have more money, some agents have less money, so it becomes unequal. So first message, the state of equality is totally unstable. You start making transactions, some people end up rich, some people end up poor. Just by probability, because first moment of the distribution is conserved because it's closed system in this model, but the second moment, the width is not. It's like any Brownian motion, diffusion, random walk, it starts to broaden, right? But that's not the end of the story. So let me run it further. Now you see, it becomes asymmetric because of the boundary condition. I put boundary condition at zero, meaning that if you spend all your money, you cannot buy anything anymore. Okay? But I can work and get money from somebody. So it becomes asymmetric because of the boundary at zero. So there is no debt here, just to get rid. There's no debt. I will introduce that later next time. But so far, no debt. That means boundary at zero. And then if I run further, it eventually stabilizes at this red curve. And this red curve is exponential distribution. Boltzmann gives exponential distribution the same as exponential distribution of energy in physics. That's what we learn in physics. If you have molecules in a gas, their probability distribution of their energies is given by exponential function. That's what Boltzmann gives. Okay, here it's exponential distribution of money. And they call this state what they call, it nature of inequality. Nature because actually, this distribution, which is highly unequal, few rich people, many poor people, it maximizes entropy. So the plot is entropy as a function of time. Entropy of this distribution is a function of time. Because Boltzmann told us that entropy is a combinatorial variable. It's a logarithm of multiplicity. That's what Boltzmann told us. And what is multiplicity? It's a number of ways to realize given configuration. So for example, the state of perfect equality, there is only one way to realize it. That means give everybody $10, that is it, no other ways. So multiplicity is 1. So logarithm of 1 is 0. So the initial state of equality had 0 entropy. It's very low entropy. And then what happens? As system evolves, entropy spontaneously increases until it reaches maximal value when it reaches exponential distribution. So as Boltzmann proved mathematically, exponential distribution maximizes entropy. Okay, subject to constraint. Yes. Why? Because it can be realized in many different ways. For example, I may have $10 and Kerry has $20. That's one realization. Well, the other way around, he has $10, I have $20. That's a different microscopic realization, but it doesn't change the whole distribution. And so one can check combinatorially this actually maximized number of ways of realizing it. Okay, so bottom line, that all this kind of distribution, natural inequality, which happens just because of randomness, just because of transfer of, there's no skills, educations and so on. Just everybody lives equally in statistical sense, like equal opportunity society. Okay, but still it develops inequality because of entropy maximization. So at this point, I think, any questions? But that's fine, yes.
Yes, it's not clear why they're exchanging money, because I would expect that the reason why they're exchanging depends on what they have that's of some value. So surely the distribution of those valuable things would have some influence on the distribution of wealth.
Okay, yes, okay. So I think, let me summarize. I think the point is, agents do not exchange money at random. They have certain purpose. They think, the goal, they whatever, yeah. What I can say, atoms in a gas, they don't move randomly. They move on purpose. They follow equations of motion. And in fact, the equations of motion in Lagrange formulas can be formulated as maximization of some function. They maximize action. Okay, so in other words, the motion of atoms in a gas is totally deterministic according to classical mechanics. And yet, the net result of this ensemble is effectively the same as random. You see, so there's a big mystery of statistical mechanics, that there is actually no contradiction between deterministic motion of individual agents or atoms and yet kind of probabilistic outcome for the whole ensemble. And the reason is because everybody has their own different goals. If you had the same goal, like in a communist society where you are, okay, everybody move in the same direction. This is obviously not random, But the point is, in the free, kind of free market society, everybody moves in their own direction. Everybody follows some goal, but individual goal. The net result, it becomes like random ensemble. That's basically my philosophical message. Other questions?
Okay. In terms of evolution, biological evolution. And I'm not quite sure where I'm going.
Yeah, let's not go into that. Okay,
You're going to finish. When you're finished, I'd like to ask you a question.
Yeah, okay, let me finish. So now, okay, first of all, there are two items I need to make. Just two messages. First point is death. Death was discussed a lot, right? So there was no death here. Of course, somebody should have said, but where is death? Where is credit? Where is it's not the real economy, Okay, fine, we can modify the simulation and introduce death. Death means allowing people negative balance. Okay? If my balance is zero, but I still want coffee, I go to a bank, I borrow money, but keep in mind, this is like particle anti-particle creation. I create a pair, actually. Positive money, I get cash, say $100 cash, and $100 debt. So I have liability, I've got debt obligation. So my net worth is still zero, because plus and minus, okay? So borrowing money by itself does not violate conservation law of money, meaning this transfer, because I create positive negative. Okay, but what it does, it relaxes boundary condition. Because now I use my positive money to buy stuff, coffee, whatever, spend it, it goes away into the system, but negative balance stays with me, so my balance becomes negative. So allowing debt means relaxing boundary condition, allowing negative balance. Now, the question is, remember, this boundary condition played a very important role. So is there any boundary condition on debt? Well, let's try first, a very extreme case. Suppose there is no restriction on debt. It means you need money, borrow, more money, borrow, even more money, borrow, no problem, go ahead. Okay? So then it's clear that as this probability distribution starts to broaden, it will never stabilize. If there is no boundary condition on either side, it will keep spreading and spreading and spreading. That means some people go infinitely in debt, so that other people become infinitely rich. Okay? And that's why we have all this debt issue. Some people want to go here. This answers one frequently asked question, how to get rich? Or how to get super rich? In order to get super rich, you need to put somebody else in debt. Okay? So that's how it works. Now I want to come to slides and just a couple of slides and I will finish. Okay, so I have one slide about debt, but maybe I should go very quickly. I mean, my point is, imposing no boundary condition on debt it looks unreasonable. I mean, it just makes no sense. I put, for example, some fixed debt. You borrow up to a limit, okay, individually. Then what happens, you shift boundary from zero to another boundary. You end up with exponential gain. It doesn't change anything qualitatively. Another possibility is you may impose limit on total debt in the whole system, not individually, but in aggregate. That actually works with something called required reserve ratio. This is the standard economic textbook on how banks work. It's called fractional reserve, requirement banking. I will not go through detail, but the bottom line, if it is imposed, it imposes the limit of the total debt in the system. Now you have two constraints. You have constraint on total positive money and total negative money. You maximize entropy and there is double exponential, which is stationary part. And it looks nice to me. This was done by the Chinese researchers. But the problem is that in the real economy, in reality, this required reserve ratio is imposed inconsistently. Meaning it's imposed only like retail bank, but not financial, investment banks, hedge funds, etc. So bottom line, in reality, there is no hard constraint on debt. And for this reason, see, system does not have stationary equilibrium. There is, as what Gail was telling us, there is no limit on debt. System will never stabilize in principle. And there's no such thing as equilibrium debt until limit is imposed externally. Anyway, so that's what I want to say about this kind of theoretical framework. Now, data. Because this was all theoretical, it was kind of fantasy. It doesn't correspond to any reality. I think I showed just three slides and a thing.
Sure.
Okay, so how about data? Now, it was turned out it was difficult to find data on money balances, because there. But there's lots of data on income distribution. So we said, okay, let's look at income. Of course, income is different from money, income is a flow of money. But let's just look at the data, because plenty of data, and this is an interesting question anyway. We get data from Bureau of Census. Downloaded data, made a histogram. So this annual income to $120,000, this is a histogram. Okay, and this solid line is a fit to exponential function. And this is pretty good here. Well, there's some deviation at the low end, but this is below $5,000 a year, it's extremely low income. There will be some difficulties there anyway. Even better, if you have exponential function, if you take logarithm, it becomes linear function. And that is it. If you plot in log linear scale, plot logarithm of probability versus income, linear scale up to 120, falls on a straight line. That proves that, in fact, distribution of income is actually exponential, empirical data. And we'll publish second paper, evidence for exponential distribution of income in the United States. Okay. However, you may ask, what about millionaires? This is only 120K, where is millionaires? They're not in this data sample because A, there's a sample, and B, this is questionnaires, reporting. Anyway, we went to another data source, and that is IRS, Internal Revenue Service, the American Tax Agency, and they have like 100 million tax returns every year. And so it's a much bigger data set. And the data point, the blue points, is as reported by IRS as a public agency, the published data. All the data, as a physicist, all I did, I reported the data. Data is available to anybody. Nobody was just posting this data. We made a graph. So anyway, this is cumulative distribution, cumulative probability distribution now. Now, so this is log linear scale. This is logarithm of probability. And this is income up to $100,000 adjusted gross income. Again, straight line means exponential distribution. From 0 to 100K, different source, different data set, same exponential. But the main panel, this goes log scale. Now this goes in logarithmic scale up to $1 million, thousands of $1,000s. And the top tail follows straight line in log coordinates, which means a power law. And so what we see is the evidence for two-class society. So the whole income distribution can be decomposed into two parts. Lower part is very well fitted by exponential function, by simplest mathematical functions. Exponential for the lower part, power law for the upper part. And remember two portraits, those who came late, I showed portraits of Boltzmann and Pareto. Both were right. And distribution actually has both parts. And in fact, this whole thing is basically two-class society. And we can take intersection point between these two fits as kind of operational boundary between classes. Okay, and then we can read up some numbers. For example, how many people are in the upper class? Okay, so we go here, this is logarithmic scale, cumulative 1 to 3%. So the upper class is 3% of population, and the lower class is 97% of population. So the great majority of population belongs to this lower exponential class. I'm pretty sure everybody in this room, yes, yeah, the financial guy from Canada is not here. Okay, but everybody.
He's coming, you'll have to show the movie right. Over again.
Yeah. But I'm pretty sure everybody in this room belongs to the lower class, so make no illusions about that. And by the way, there is no such thing as middle class. Because you see, from 0 to 100K is completely smooth in a straight line. If you want to put a boundary for the middle class, tell me where to put the boundary. There is no natural break point. But there is natural break point between lower class and upper class. So these are the 99%. This is, 97, 99, not a big deal, small quantitative difference. But the point is, there is actual hard empirical evidence for it.
Might be a mass,
yes, that's right. There is hard, this is what biophysics, I approach as a physicist. I plot data points, and I feed them as an experiment. I see the evidence for two classes. Of course, I learned Marx in my undergraduate studies, but this is the data. Anyway, okay, so this was for one particular year. But what about other years? We can do this exercise for every year, get the same thing, and get this linear slope. From the slope, we get temperature. Temperature, remember, in income temperature. Income temperature is just the average income, the parameter in the exponential distribution. Then what we do, we normalize. Now we take data for 30 years, from 80s, 90s, 2000. And for each year, we do this exercise, log linear plot, we extract the temperature. Now we normalize. So this is now normalized, rescaled income. Income normalized to income temperature this year. One means the mean. And what you see in log linear, this is data for 80s, 90s, 2000, they all fall on the same line in log linear scale log log. So basically what it shows is that exponential doesn't change, exponential part of the distribution doesn't change at all. That means relative inequality within lower class, 97% population, doesn't change at all. 30 years pass by, you know, inequality relative to the average, relative to the mean, doesn't change at all. But what does change is the share of the upper class, the share that goes to the upper class. And that has a lot of dynamics, and all this income inequality we hear about from upper class. So my real last slide. So let me skip this one. Let's keep in this one. Let's keep in Lorentz curve. Yeah. So that is it. So this is this function f. This is a share of income going to the upper class as a function of time. It was about 10% up to 95. From 95 started increased 20%. That was dot-com bubble, crashed. Then housing bubble exceeded 20%, it crashed. And the latest one we call QE bubble. Central bank prints money and gives it to the bankers. And bankers say, thank you very much. And there is big increase of inequality. It all goes to the upper class. Because there's no other mechanism for Federal Reserve to give money. There's no mechanism for them giving money to us. They only give to bankers. And that's what they do. And that's it, okay. So that's basically what happens. And Gini coefficient can be completely, there's a formula. There's a formula. I can derive very simple formula for Gini coefficient. And Gini coefficient can be completely, here's the formula, can be expressed in this function f. And so all the evolution of Gini coefficient follows this formula. And the same thing in European Union, this is the Poland log linear scale, this is euros. This is what they call Europe income distribution. And what you see again follows exponential up to this point, so 97% population Europe also follows exponential. So I'm gonna stop here because I ran out of time. Okay, so thanks a lot. And
okay, so next up, I think we're going to skip to Carrie because you're substituted out, and then let's have one question while we're changing.
You want to look at the computer? So question, you want to ask question or somebody?
Yeah, I'd like to ask a question.
Oh, yeah, you said
computer. Right, I want to look at the computer.
Okay. So the question I have, you've been working on this model since 2000, correct?
Yes.
So I'm sure nobody's pointed this out to you, but a fundamental error and conceptual error. You have a number of technical errors in your presentation, but also a number of fundamental errors.
Yes.
One is that you're confusing conservation of energy with conservation of force. So for example...
Let me stop right here. As a physicist, I cannot tolerate this. There is conservation of energy. There is no conservation of force. Maybe we'll stop here, because that is physics, you know. We know in physics there is no conservation of force. So there's no point to proceed already. So maybe we'll discuss later, because there is no conservation of force in physics.
Okay. Well, thank you again, Victor.